Hello YouTube, welcome to this video about stimulants. For the people who have paid attention to the community page, I've posted a meme on the topic a few days ago, and if you've been keeping up with my practices, you know that it's usually the announcement of a big video that's coming, and it's a method that I'm going to employ more and more on the channel because it allows me to sort of, you know, test the waters, see how you guys feel, and also get a lot of good data about your perception of the topic. Because if I post a meme and I get no real adverse reactions, then I know that it's not really super interesting to talk about it in the moment. But this time I had a lot of people get upset about what I said. And this to me is an indication that I have work to do. So I made this video for you guys because I think that you need help. And I'm here to provide that help. With that meme, I carried a certain level of disdain towards people who take stimulants and caffeine. But I want to reassure you right now, this video is not going to be a 50-minute long attack on people who drink coffee because it's a waste of time. There is no reason for me to even do that because it's going to lead nowhere. The meme was offensive on purpose because that's what I do on that community page. I upset people. But it's more intricate than that. The topic is more interesting than just saying that people who drink coffee are wimps. There are underlying reasons for my dislike of caffeine, and I want to explain them to you today, not just so that I can appear better than you are, but so that I can help you, because I do believe that you have a problem. And that problem is that you are addicted to stimulants. So for me to be able to even approach that topic, I need to be constructive. So this video is going to be very well structured and more balanced than just a stupid meme where I attack you. There will be no ad hominem attacks today. Or if they exist, if they appear, they're going to be justified by actual explanations that follow. The topic in general, as I said, will be stimulants, but I'm going to have a strong focus on coffee because it's the main culprit. And by saying that, I also need to offer you a scope for the type of people that I'm targeting with that video. If you drink one cup of coffee every 2 days, if you can go without caffeine without any problems, or if you even don't consume it at all, you're not my target audience. My target audience is the people who got upset at the meme, because they are the ones that can learn from me. If you're not in that category, again, you can still watch the video, of course, but you're not going to get as much as a benefit because this is really going to be constructed so that it can help people who are addicted to stimulants to see the mistakes of their ways and help them understand where they went wrong. Because I don't think that you're inferior to me because you consume caffeine. It would be insane. I do think, however, that you're hurting yourself because you are being led down a path that is not beneficial for you. So, by saying that, I also know that I'm going to meet some resistance because any type of controversial topic is going to meet resistance. It's natural. Your resistance to me is a sign that you know that what you're doing is wrong. And by wrong, I don't mean like morally wrong. I wipe my ass with morality. I don't care about that. Wrong in the sense that it's bad for you in the long run and even in the short term. And the proof of that is the fact that you clicked. You clicked on this video. And you also left a comment underneath the meme, which shows that it got to you. There's some level of what I said that got to you. It upset you. In this life, if something makes you upset, it's that there is a part of it that resonates with you and maybe is holding a mirror to your face that is showing a reflection that you don't really enjoy seeing. And that, to me, is an opportunity to get better. You do not want to let your emotions take you away from progression. You do not want to just have a knee-jerk reaction. This is the worst thing you can do. And I know that by being inflammatory, you can sometimes push people away. You can let them retrench themselves because it's a natural reaction of humans. Actually, the best way to make people believe a certain thing for the rest of their life is to attack them on it and challenge it as if it were a fight. Because then you challenge their identity and that leads people to retreating very aggressively because they feel, again, as if you were targeting them. So know, please, that I'm not targeting you as a person. I'm targeting a problem, okay? You might be affected by the problem, but I don't see you as part of it. I see someone in you that has room for improvement, and I want to offer you that room. So please, please watch the video until the end with an open mind and with honesty in your heart. I am not your enemy, okay? I am not trying to tell you that you're a miserable piece of shit because you drink coffee. I want you to better yourself. That is it. That is my true intention. So listen to my arguments. And then at the end, if you disagree, we can discuss it in the comments. But if you don't listen and you just look at the title and you dislike, you are hurting yourself. It's not hurting me, it's hurting you. And I know that this video will have more dislikes than usual. It doesn't matter to me, but I would at least appreciate if you gave it a listen, if you actually try to take in some of the arguments. This is made extremely difficult, of course, by the fact that discussing addiction means touching on uncomfortable truths. And no one likes uncomfortable topics. No one. And it's the reason why, of course, this topic has never been really discussed on YouTube Fitness, is because people know how attached most individuals are to their caffeine. And so they will never actually, you know, stir the pot because it's too risky. They don't want people to hate them or to unsubscribe. I personally, again, don't give a fuck. If you want to unsubscribe, please do it. But for the rest, for the people who will actually give me a shot, I think that I can help. I truly believe that I can help to open your eyes and to make you realize certain things. Things that you have started to realize yourself, but that you're trying to shy away from because you're addicted. You are addicted to caffeine. And because of that, your judgment is clouded completely and you have lost any objectivity. An objectivity that I hope I can restore to you today with this video, with what I selected in terms of logical arguments. And in this case, the issue, of course, with discussing with addicts is that they have very strong coping mechanisms put in place to explain why what they're doing is not dangerous or not bad, etc. I know it's almost impossible, but please try to shut them down for the duration of the video. Your excuses and your counterarguments don't work because for the most part, I've already heard them and I'm going to debunk them as I go. The only thing they're doing is they're hurting you. You're essentially the type of person that is barricading their door when there is a fire inside their own apartment. This is not for your benefit. Not letting people enter is not making your life better. It's just making you feel better about the fact that you're shutting down voices that tell you you have a problem. But I guarantee you that you have one. And I've discussed addiction with people who are in much graver situations than people addicted to coffee. So I have a certain amount of experience with the subject matter. Your addiction is not insanely bad, okay? I'm not saying that you're going to die tomorrow, but I am saying, however, that it is still an addiction. And the worst thing you can do is to refute that and to try and say that you're not. Because if you refuse to see the problem, you can never actually face it. And just to close on that topic, I know it's a battle that is already lost because it's extremely tough to get through to people who are on drugs, because again, caffeine is a drug. It's categorized as one that is very widely consumed, but it doesn't make it any less of a drug. And the fact that you are so desperately trying to defend it shows that it's a drug, because if it were any other substance and I told you, hey, this is bad, you wouldn't even have any amount of emotional, you know, awakening within you. If I told you, hey, you need to stop eating, I don't know, croissants. If someone told me stop eating croissants, you think I would get upset? No, because I'm not addicted to croissants. Although I am a Frenchman, so technically I am. But your resistance is a sign of the underlying problem. So that is the big, big thing that I wanted to put forth before I start discussing the actual caffeine addiction, the issues and the sources and the reason why you're addicted. And as I said, if you weren't addicted, you wouldn't feel anything about my words. People who just like coffee, who for the taste of coffee, who drink it once in a while, or even who drink it often, but are not addicted, wouldn't get upset because they can quit at any moment. You are not in that category. You cannot quit. This is why you're addicted. If you tell me I can quit whenever, well, then quit today. If you can't, you're addicted. Okay, just accept that. If you don't accept that, you will never get better, ever. But of course, many of you are telling yourself that you don't need to get any better, you're already good. If you are just that unwilling to compromise, then I can't do anything for you. But I understand why you're in that state of mind. It's because stimulants are designed to be addictive. So it's not really your fault. It's the reason why I opened by saying that I'm not passing a judgment of value onto you. I'm not saying you're a terrible person. I am saying, however, that I understand perfectly why you might not be as receptive as you could be to my arguments. And that is because you are simply not in the correct state of mind. And in terms of addictions and in the broader term, the very nature of stimulants make them addictive because they are very exciting and fun, right? And since your baseline in everyday life is here, anything that gives you like a big increase in happiness or in energy is going to, by default, be very addictive. I don't think that it's something that you can even argue against. And so the product in itself is an invitation towards addiction that some people resist because they're just wired differently or they have a better relationship with the product. But for you, it clearly is not the case. And a good example that I have with coffee, for example, and the interestingly addictive nature of it is the fact that many people have rituals associated with coffee. Usually when you have a ritual with something, it's not necessarily always bad, but I found that when it's a substance that you consume, it tends to be. Meaning that I don't know any people who have a ritual with consuming water or with consuming pasta, but almost every single person I know who drinks coffee has ritualized the consumption to an extent or another. And that to me is a sign. It's a sign that this substance is very important in your life because you have literally made it into some sort of divinity, a very important part of your day. And it's also the reason why it's so tough to speak against, because there is a very high amount of emotional attachment between you and coffee. For some people, it even makes you think of your parents, because most likely the first people who introduced you to coffee were your mom and dad. Maybe you had a cup of Joey, I think we say that like this in English, in the morning with your dad. And that, of course, bounds you profoundly with that consumption. Maybe it's your little thing in the morning before the kids wake up and you have your coffee with your wife and it's just the two of you. Maybe at the end of a long day before you get to the gym, you watch a video about any YouTubers or whatever and you drink your coffee. That's a pre-gym ritual. All of that is good. I'm not saying that it's bad. It's a cultural thing and it's very social. The issue is in what you're doing it, in the substance that you consume while you do it. If someone told me that their ritual before bed is smoking a joint, even though that might be very relaxing for them and helping them go to sleep, it's still very toxic because they have turned something, the ritual, into the consumption of a product that then makes it impossible for them to give up the product because it is too ritualized. So keep that in mind because I'll go back to that. And in terms of excuses or things that I'm going to hear, I'm going to get rid of them right now because it's going to make it tougher for you to accept my arguments because you're going to think that you have the ability to counter them and you don't. So I'm just going to lay them flat here. Most of them come from the meme that I posted and the comments I got, but all of them I were already familiar with. So I already prepared counter arguments. I don't do that to debunk you and tell you, oh, look at me, I'm 200 IQ and you're stupid. I do that to clear the way, to remove the excuses you've always been using to justify your caffeine consumption, and so that you can be actually freed from it and potentially open a breach that I can then enter to talk to you directly and not talk to the person who's addicted. Because there are two types, or rather there are two faces of addiction. There's the addicted face, and then there's the person that's beneath the addiction. I'm talking to the person beneath it, okay? The guy with the addiction mask, I don't talk to him. And right now, I'm going to shut him down so I can talk to you. The first excuse I hear a ton is people who say, well, you tell me that depending on coffee is bad, but you depend on things too, like water or food. I opened it with this one because it's the stupidest one. You'll see that I'm not going to strawman in this video. I'm going to actually use the arguments that these people use. So the it's like water argument is, of course, profoundly stupid because water doesn't have the impact that coffee has on you. Water is a base. It actually does really nothing. The absence of water is dangerous, but not the consumption of it. It has no effect. Coffee has a direct effect on your body. By the way, is the reason why you consume it. If you didn't feel anything after you consume coffee, you would not actually drink coffee. I think that's a given. But on top of that, it's all the more egregious because it's presenting coffee as a human need, as something that you cannot do without. And I know that it's a trend nowadays to try and present a lot of things that are completely dispensable as something that is vital, like for example, internet providers, healthcare. None of that is vital, and you are not owed any of that stuff. You can survive without them, and if you want them, you need to procure them yourself. But for coffee, it's even more disingenuous because you can live without coffee perfectly fine. And actually, the reason why you're telling yourself that you can't is because you drink coffee. But I'll get back to that. The ironic side and the joke of it all, in reality, when people tell you that it's just like water, is the fact that coffee actually dehydrates you. I don't know if you knew that, but a cup of coffee puts you like in a negative in terms of hydration because it takes more water for your system to actually digest and process the caffeine than you actually ingest by drinking the coffee. So if for the people who drink a ton of tea and coffee all the time, you are not hydrating yourself. You're doing quite the opposite. And just so you know, the problem with that is that coffee, en français on dit se désaltérer. Coffee is killing your thirst, meaning that you're not thirsty anymore after you drink it, but it doesn't do anything for actual hydration. So you're stuffing your face with a liquid that makes you feel like you don't need to drink, when in reality, you should. And it's like sodas. Many people drink a ton of soda throughout the day and they say, well, I'm not thirsty, so I must be hydrated. No, you're drinking something that kills your thirst, but you are still in need of water. It's like if you met someone who's taking appetite killers and like anti-appetite pills and they told you, well, clearly I'm not hungry, so I don't need to eat. No, you bypassed the need to eat. It doesn't mean that you don't need it. And let me tell you one thing, being constantly dehydrated throughout the day is the best way to develop chronic illnesses as you age. So pay attention to that. Coffee doesn't hydrate you at all. It's also a laxative, and I know a lot of people take that as a positive and they say, oh, I love coffee, it makes me shit. If you need coffee to shit, you have gastrointestinal problems because coffee is a strong laxative. So for the people who can only take a shit if they have their coffee in the morning, it's the equivalent, again, of someone who needed laxative pills in the morning to be able to take a shit. You have a problem, and your addiction is already starting to snowball into potential health complications because you're using coffee as a palliative for proper digestion and then proper exertion of your feces. This is not normal. So be very careful and on the ball when it comes to that. Coffee has an impact on you when it comes to health. And one thing that I wanted to add as well when it comes to that, coffee has actually also the ability, yes, to prevent you from being tired. That's the reason why you drink it. But it's also, in a sense, not really doing that at all. Just like with the hydration thing. It makes you think you're not tired. It wires up your brain. But at the end of the day, you're still tired, right? Again, we're going to use the two masks metaphor. The addicted face on the surface is not tired, but the one inside is. Your inner self is still very tired. And that has been proved, by the way, times and times again, because there are studies that have showed that people who drink, who sleep 3 to 4 hours a night tend to take bad decisions. They have poor impulse control, they have lower reflexes, and they have lower muscle contractions. And so what they wanted to see is if coffee could actually solve that problem. So they gave coffee to the same people, and what they found is that there was no difference, meaning that the two categories performed the exact same way, had the same bad impulse control, but one felt awake and the other one didn't. Because, again, coffee doesn't replace sleep. It cannot replace sleep. And on top of that, for something even more dire, and this might, some people point that and say it's fear-mongering. It's not. I'm just trying to tell you what you're doing when you drink caffeine. The researchers have started to link the Alzheimer's disease to a certain type of pollutant that is in the brain that usually gets rinsed when you sleep. And usually in a normal, healthy person, every time you go to sleep, your brain gets reset, all of the toxins are flushed, and you start anew. And those toxins are accumulated throughout the day when you think and you do things. In people with Alzheimer's, they have found a very high concentration of these toxins in the brain, and they found also that sleeping does not flush them out. The reason why I tell you this is because when you drink coffee and you reduce the amount of time you sleep, guess what you're doing? You're not allowing the body to flush these toxins. And those same studies have shown that people who drink a lot of coffee tend to have more of them in the brain. I am not saying you're going to develop Alzheimer because of coffee. I'm saying, however, that you're hurting the normal chemistry and mechanisms of your brain because of your consumption. So for the it's like water crew, no, it's not. Two, it's healthy. I hear that one a ton too, which, by the way, is an inversion of value, the likes of which I have rarely seen. People, big companies that sell it for the most part, have managed to convince the public that coffee is actually good, that it's actually good for you, and that drinking coffee is not a disadvantage, it's an actual benefit to your health. That is completely untrue to an extent, meaning that just like with anything in life, the poison is in the dosages. Yes, you can drink a cup of coffee here and there and actually get benefits from it. I absolutely believe that. And I think that for a lot of people who are more on the lower end of the spectrum in terms of energy levels, it can actually have a very beneficial impact. It can boost your health and it can improve cardiovascular resistance. That is quite possible. But if you admit that there is a category of the population that benefits from coffee, you have to admit that there is another one that doesn't. And you can be potentially found within that category. Now, if you increase the dose and you take more and more coffee, this category gets slimmer and slimmer, and this one gets bigger and bigger. It's a normal distribution, meaning that for the most part, if you're addicted to coffee, it's not doing anything for your health. And for the people who are going to cite me studies, look at who pays for the study. Please have the intellectual honesty to do your research properly. Look who paid for the study and don't stop at a name. If it's a name, look who the person is, look them up, look their ties with industries and companies. You will find 4 times out of 5 that these are paid for by coffee companies. I don't know if you knew that, but coffee is a $1 billion industry that is employing a ton of people and they have a massive amount of power. It's one of the strongest lobby in the world. You don't think they have the ability to fake studies or to just misdirect the understanding of the study to fit their goal? Their goal in life is to sell you coffee. Of course, they'll do it. But I know that many people on this channel are going to still use that as a reason why coffee is good, because you are always happy to put aside your integrity when it serves your purpose and your agenda. And that to me is a sign of addiction, because you are blindly following the writing and studies of people who have skewed them on purpose for profit, and you, the person who is actually being victimized by that practice, are actually starting to defend them. So don't cite me no fucking studies. The studies for the most part are bunk, because they always fail to take into account that overconsumption of caffeine can lead to damage. They always pick very small dosages, which do not represent the majority of people who are addicted, because addiction also includes the idea that you take too much too often. And to finish on this, for the people who are going to cite me the antioxidants of coffee, I don't know if you knew that, but when you boil coffee, most of the antioxidants disappear because they cannot resist high heat. So unless you're drinking cold brewed coffee, you're not getting any antioxidants. And I think you know that, because don't fucking lie to me. You don't drink coffee for the antioxidants. You don't sip on your cup thinking, the good antioxidants. No, you drink it because it makes you more awake. That's it. Stop with the lies. Same for the people who say, I like the taste. If you like the taste, that's good, but understand that you're not my target audience. I target the people who drink coffee for the effects, okay, not for the preposterous health benefits. You want antioxidants? Grab a few blueberries, eat that. That's more antioxidants than your entire cup of coffee. So that's for the health thing. Also not a respectable or acceptable argument. The third one is, I need it. This is the the clear-cut sign that you're addicted. You need it. The only thing you need as a human being in life is water and food. Oxygen, of course. Sleep to an extent. And then social interactions. That's the big five. Anything else you don't need. But you have managed to go so deep down the rabbit hole that you have convinced yourself that you need caffeine. You know why you need it? Because one day you woke up tired, you took coffee, it helped, and you have entered a stage in a mode where you cannot now exist without it. So in a sense, you're correct, you need it, but it's not because it's a natural or a beneficial thing to consume. A heroin addict needs heroin. Does it mean that it's good for him? No. Am I comparing the two? No. One is much worse than the other, of course. But if you look at raw numbers of people, there are many more people addicted to caffeine than heroin. So it's something that needs to be tackled with the same energy. So you don't need coffee. You are just in a massive Stockholm syndrome where you are in love with your abuser because, of course, you are getting benefits. That's one thing, also, of course, that must be mentioned. Stimulants are addictive because they give you benefits. And what are the benefits? They make you more awake. They make you more aware. And these benefits are very tangible, unlike the health consequences. Because many people who drink coffee will never realize the health consequences. The only thing that they see is the benefits. Does that sound familiar to you? That's exactly like steroids. People who take roids see all of the good things, the muscle gain, the pump, the feeling of confidence. What they don't see is what's going on underneath the surface and all of the damage that it's causing. You are in this exact situation. I also have noticed, especially in the comments of the meme, that the people who say that understand, I think, that to an extent they are pathetic because they are dependent on coffee. And so they always fire back with ad hominem attack. And the ones that I've seen the most is people who told me, well, I work X amount of hours and I do this and that, so of course I need coffee. Like I don't do that. But what do you think I do all day? You think I'm laying there and then once a while I get up and I do a video, then I go back here? I work also. For the people who are like, oh, I work X amount of hours. I work 55 hours a week. I train 15 hours a week. I do YouTube videos. I go out with my family, with my friends. I do things too. And you know what? There are millions of people who work just as much as you do who don't drink coffee. So maybe you need it, but if we compare you to the rest of the population that's not addicted, that is shining a horrible light on you and on your addiction. And I think it's something you know. Because if you need to fire back with ad hominem attacks when someone is just making an observation, it shows that there is something wrong. Again, you got upset and now you're emotional, you're in your feelings, but it's preventing you from actually seeing the truth. And to continue with an example that I think is going to make you think, you're telling me that you need coffee, like you need coffee. And if you can't have coffee, you cannot train, you cannot work, you cannot be yourself. It, to me, is very similar to a situation that would involve someone who would tell you, for example, that they need alcohol to have fun. And I know that you know people like this because I do as well. I know people who tell me that if not, they're not drinking, they cannot enjoy themselves in social interactions or in parties. And when you point that out and say, hey, that's an addiction, you're addicted to alcohol, they also get upset likewise because they know that they're dependent on a substance. They admit it because they say that they need it. But when someone comes and actually tries to point it out and say, okay, you just said it, you're addicted, now they retreat. And I think it's a sort of cry for help. You are saying what you know. You are saying that you're dependent, but then there's still that portion of you that will not accept it fully. And to me, it's a sign that you need to change. If I met a dude and he told me, hey, like for some reason we're talking about that topic, I don't know why, he's telling me to be able, for example, he's telling me, oh, to be able to have sex with my wife, I need to be drunk first. Well, I'll tell the guy, hey, you have a problem. You know you have a problem, right? And on top of that, I will also insist on the fact that most likely, if you need to be drunk to be able to have sex with your partner, it means that you don't really love your partner. That is a given. Now, let's look at it from the caffeine point of view. If you need to be wired up on grams, on milligrams and milligrams of caffeine to be able to train, what does it say about relationship with training? most likely you're not as dedicated as you think you are, and you might not even really like it. What you like is the stimulants. And that, by the way, is perfectly acceptable. But you need to be honest with yourself. Tell yourself, what I love is stimulants. Because in reality, you're not really a lifter. You could be taking stimulants and, you know, running on the beach or playing with a dog. You would still get the same benefits in terms of enjoyment. So why don't you do it? Well, I think it's because, again, you have underestimated the amount of importance that stimulants take in your practice and the space that they're taking. But I'm going to discuss the space a little bit later. And to close on that argument also, I hear people say, well, I need it because I slept 3 hours. Okay, that's your own fault. I don't see how you could use that as an argument. You slept 3 hours, so what? You slept 3 hours because you failed to actually schedule properly. And again, for the few rare individuals who are going to tell me, well, I work 90 hours a week and that's all the sleep I can get. Okay, you're an exception. Like, you're not the person I'm talking about. The people who are going to tell me, I do a 25-hour shift as a nurse and then I train, so I drink coffee. Okay, but same, you're an exception. You're not the type of person that I'm pointing out today. I'm pointing out the fuckers who sleep 7 hours and then wake up to go to an office job and who need their coffee. That is abnormal, but it's now the normal circumstance that most people deal with. Most people I know are like this. In France, people say, tant que j'ai pas mon café, je peux rien faire. Meaning, as long as I don't have coffee, I can't do anything. That is abnormal. I want you to know that this is not normal. A normal person, like myself, when we wake up, we're already energized. I need like 5 minutes to like rub my eyes, then drink some water, and I'm in. For the rest of the day, I'm in. I don't have a dip in energy at any point. It's stable because it's the way the human body is built. Right, again, you need it because you work so hard. People 200 years ago worked just as hard. They didn't have coffee. They just used the natural energetical boost that the body provides to be able to get through their day. You have that ability as well, but you replaced it with massive intakes of coffee, and that is a big problem. And to finish up with the bad excuses that I do not want to hear, people who say that it boosts performance. You're correct. Coffee does boost performance. The problem with your mindset is that you've integrated the idea that the only way to access that boost is through coffee, and that is simply not correct. Because you can get the same boost with a normal activation of your adrenaline. And the way to do that is quite simple. If you want to know how, I made a video about it. It's in the description. It's only 9 minutes long, and it details everything you need to do to have full control over your adrenal glands. You do not need to be drinking coffee. You have never needed that, by the way. And I'm sure that you know that. The problem is that since now you have access to PRs and you have access to certain heightened capacities via coffee, you have lost the ability to do it without it. It doesn't mean that it never existed, and it certainly does not mean that the consumption of coffee to access it is a good thing. Again, quite the opposite. So that is it for the excuses that I'm not going to cover. Again, if you put them in the comments, I'm not going to even answer it, because again, they're not receivable. We're going to now go into the problem with coffee, the damage that it does to your body, the reason why you are addicted, and what you can do to actually get away from it. But before that, I'm going to check the time. All right. So, there is one thing with coffee consumption that have always annoyed me, that I think is a big problem, and it goes directly, it stems from the performance thing I just described. Many people fundamentally misunderstand what coffee is and what caffeine in general is. People think that caffeine is energy. So they see a cup of coffee and they think, I drink this, gets into the body, turns into energy, and that's why I feel good, that's why I feel awake. That is not true. I hope that you know that. Caffeine is a messenger that is telling the body to increase adrenaline production. That is what it does. It's basically strong-arming the body, or even tricking the body into producing these hormones. Hormones that, by the way, the body would naturally produce if you just slept. If you just slept naturally through the night, the body would give you these hormones the second you wake up. But it doesn't in your case, because you have entered a relationship with coffee that is, in a sense, preventing you from even having to do it. But just like with steroids, where your normal hormonal profile shuts down, it's not a good thing. Because coffee isn't energy, it draws it from you. And the problem with that is that it cannot draw something that is not there. Meaning that it's sometimes forcing the body into overproducing these hormones when the body doesn't want to. Is the reason why, by the way, when you wake up and you slept 3 hours, you're tired. A lot of people feel victimized by their own body when that happens. Like, oh, I feel terrible, fucking body. You did that. It's not your body that is making you feel bad. You failed to provide the body what it needs, and now it's giving you what you deserve, which is being tired, because it just doesn't have the necessary reserves to produce the hormones that would make you feel awake. But you, instead of thinking about it and thinking, I need to treat my body properly. No, you went and you circumvented the entire thing by drinking coffee. What do you think it's doing to your body in the long run? It is not sustainable at all. Because again, when you drink your coffee, it's not energy you're consuming. You're forcing the body to again give you that extra boost, when in reality, the body doesn't want to. And when the body doesn't want to, it's for a very simple reason. It's because it can't. Or it understands that if it does, there's going to be a problem, just like steroids. Testosterone injections don't make the muscles bigger. They tell the body that the muscles must get bigger because there is enough of an anabolic environment for them to be. And so the muscles grow. But they don't grow off of the test. It's the body that is forcing them to grow and to hyphen the protein synthesis. The problem is that since this is being hyphened, it's coming from somewhere, because it's not the injection that's doing that again. So where does it come from? Well, the vitality of your tendons, which is the reason why a lot of steroid users tear their tendons, the vitality of your organs, and the vitality of the entirety of the body. Coffee is very similar in that aspect. Because your body's reserves aren't infinite. I don't know if you believe that, and if you just think that if you keep upping the dose of caffeine, you're going to be fine. You won't. Because, again, you can drink as much coffee as you want. The only thing it's doing when you drink more is that you're sending more messengers towards the actual systems responsible for hormonal production, telling them, hey, we want more, we want more, we want more. It doesn't mean that it's a good thing. If anything, it is a very bad thing. Because the reserves that I'm talking about need to be replenished. Just like with anything in life, again, you cannot create something from nothing. So anything that you spend, you spend. It's gone. And then it needs to come again. It needs to be replaced. But you are making sure that it never happens, because you're constantly drinking more and more coffee when you feel more and more tired. And that leads to adrenal fatigue. A term that I know a lot of people don't like. And I've seen a lot of knee-jerk reactions towards that term. People who say, oh, it's not scientifically proven. That's nonsense. And that is also a sign and the perfect representation of how hypocritical people can be, because they will always use science when it actually serves their cause. But the second that it doesn't and it contradicts their belief, now it doesn't work anymore. Like, they'll push it away and say, oh, no, this one I don't like. This one, it's poo-poo. I don't like this one. Well, I'm sorry for all of the deniers, but adrenal fatigue is a real thing. Because why wouldn't it be? Your body produces adrenaline. You think it can just do it forever and that there's no drawback? Have you ever been in a car accident? Have you ever been in a fight? When that happens, your adrenaline levels go here. You know what happens afterwards? They go here and you feel tired for 2 days. As if you run a marathon and your energy levels are zero. Why? Because your body had to produce a spike of adrenaline and now it's spent. Now imagine if you did that and then the next day you felt tired and you drank coffee. What are you doing essentially? You're forcing a machine that's already tired to go back into production mode. You think it's a good thing? I don't think so, but that's essentially what you're doing, because you have most likely started to enter a type of mode where every time you're not getting the amount of hormones you want, you just drink more caffeine. And that is simply not sustainable. Because if we're going to talk about the very nature of stimulants, stimulants trick your body. They don't replace sleep. They just trick the body into thinking that it doesn't need sleep. But it still does. Because sleep, as I told you, is necessary for many reasons. It is a mode in which the body can fully recuperate. And it's not just your adrenal levels that recuperate when you sleep. It's everything else. Your brain, as I said, your heart. Think about your heart. When you sleep, your heartbeat slows down. Tremendously so. You know what that does? It's giving some rest to the poor organ. The muscle needs to actually recuperate as well. But for you, what you do is this. You sleep less and less, so the heart has less and less time to recuperate. And on top of that, you consume a substance that is heightening your heartbeat. What do you think will be the consequences down the line? If you ask anyone who is a cardiologist, for example, they will tell you that a lot of the people that they have to deal with and heal who had a heart attack in their 50s and 60s tend to be people who consumed a lot of coffee. And yes, there are other factors like obesity, etc., but coffee plays a role. And that also is logical. If you deny it, then you're just denying something that is in plain sight. Your heart needs to rest. You don't let it rest, and then you overstimulate it. What exactly do you think is going to happen? You're going to have to deal with deficiencies in that organ, and that's no fun. You don't want to do that. And I know that for all of you guys, you're in your 20s, and you tell me, oh, it will never happen to me. Well, not right now, Buster, but eventually it will. And on that day, what are you going to say to yourself? You were warned, but you didn't listen to the warning. And that will put you in a constant state of being under-recovered. It's the reason why I think the people who say that they drink coffee to be more performant are missing the point. You might be more performant in the instant, even though you could have the same type of performance if you learned how to control your adrenaline levels. But on a more homeostatic basis, the state that your body is in is not beneficial or healthy because it's constantly under-recovered. And recovery is just as important as training. So if your performance is amazing in the gym, but then you don't recover properly afterwards, then it's all for nothing. And the problem is that coffee is a trade-off. And I think you know that better than anyone if you drink it. You drink your coffee, okay, you have a killer workout, but then afterwards you don't sleep well, you wake up several times. You wake up tired and you drink more coffee. That time that you spent caffeinated is time that you didn't spend recovering because you didn't really sleep. And so, in the long run, all of the damage due to the muscles and the body via your training, which is beneficial, will not be matched by your recovery. You have now entered an unbalanced state. You're performing more and more thanks to coffee, but your recovery is going lower and lower. And this is going to lead eventually to a problem because you need balance in your training. And this is the coffee vicious circle that many people enter. Many people have actually fell for that circle. And it's not just you, by the way. It's not just the 20-year-olds who take pre-workout or the guy who's like 25 and he walks a long shift and he drinks coffee. It's the entire world. It's the reason why, by the way, talking about it is so difficult is because everyone is addicted to coffee pretty much. Very rare is the person who can drink a few cups here and there and just, you know, let it go whenever. A lot of the time, people don't have a choice. And again, I know people like this. When they wake up, if they don't have coffee, there is nothing happening. Like, I'm not kidding. They will not go to work because they didn't have coffee. And that is not normal again. I really want to push that idea that it is not normal. You are supposedly able to wake up and go to work. And if you tell me, well, it doesn't matter, I can just drink coffee, I'm explaining to you why that solution that you found is not a good one. Because you were at some point in your life, regardless of who you are, able to exist without caffeine. Correct or not correct? Correct. Okay, so what happened to you? Well, most likely, you were either introduced to it by your parents or a peer, and therefore it's now emotionally tied to who you are, it's a ritual of sorts, or you lacked sleep, people told you, hey, if you're tired, just have a coffee. You drank coffee, it made you feel more awake, and you were like, that's actually amazing. And so, instead of fixing the problem, you just put a band-aid on it. That doesn't work. The problem is that you are taking again the feeling of tiredness as something that is not tolerable, and so you remove it with the help of coffee. But you being tired is your body saying, hey, I need more. Sleep, I need more. And sleeping, by the way, is very important. I do not understand people who are trying to present sleeping as a waste of time, especially when these same people would point out at people like me and say, oh, you're trying to act badass because you don't drink coffee. No, I'm not. I don't have the need to do that because I know that what I'm doing is correct and natural and healthy. What you're doing isn't. I don't have to feel superior to you. It's not something that I'm interested in. But the fact that people are trying to flip the script and say, well, I drink coffee and I sleep less than you, so I'm better than you. No, you're not. But you're trying to convince yourself because it would make you feel better. Sleeping is absolutely essential. There is nothing wrong with sleeping. There is something wrong, however, with not sleeping and replacing it with coffee, because you lack sleep, you drink coffee, then you don't sleep because you have coffee, and you drink more coffee. And that circle will lead you to full blast stimulant addiction, where you cannot even think or fathom an existence without your cup of coffee. And I know that many people watching me right now are exactly like this. You cannot function without stimulants. And I know that you know it's a problem, but you're also deeply scared of going without them because you know that the debt you're going to have to pay is immense, because that's adrenal fatigue. For all of the deniers, you can deny all you want. Your body is taking count, okay? It's keeping the tab, and that tab will be paid either by an early death, as I described, or the day when you finally get off caffeine and you're going to have to pay for all of those cups you drink, all of that fatigue you showed away. Because again, coffee doesn't actually get rid of the fatigue. It just pushes it. It's the equivalent of someone who, I don't know, has who has dust on his floor. And they take a swiper and they just swipe it away. Did you get rid of the dust? No, you just push it further. What if you do it every day? There is a wall of dust that is accumulating. The day you have to actually get rid of that is going to be a bitch, because it's going to be much tougher than getting rid of the small specks of dust. Same for you. The day you are tired, instead of thinking, let me get coffee to feel better. No. Endure, suffer the tiredness, get rid of it via sleep and rest and recover, and then you'll feel better. But coffee has put its finger in that mechanism because you have allowed it to. And this has led you to not only be in a state of constant dependence on the substance, but it also, as I said, is a slow debt that you're accumulating that's making you anxious, because the more time you wait, the tougher it is going to be to get rid of it. Coffee and caffeine is not just something that you drink and is in your system for 24 hours. It spends much more time within your bloodstream than you think, and it has a negative impact throughout the week. You can drink a cup of coffee on Monday, it can have an impact on your sleep on Tuesday. And that is a truth. And the problem is that a lot of people think, well, if I can still sleep when I drink coffee, what is the problem? Well, the quality of your sleep is damaged. That is the problem. You're not recovering as much as you could. And so, if you are in that situation and you readily admit that there is something going wrong, well then, here is the problem. Here is what happened to you. You are caught into the circle of coffee consumption, and the only thing that can prevent you from actually going down that path and continuing on that mistake is to stop. And to stop, you're going to have to slowly, you know, get rid of coffee, deal with the tiredness, pay back the debt, but eventually you're going to be very happy you did. Every single person I know who quit coffee and caffeine in general feels much better. So this is what I believe you should be doing. But beyond that, now that coffee addiction has been fully tackled, in my opinion, we can also talk to the other problems that coffee creates in your life, because I've always found that coffee ties strongly with other addictions. And that to me is a sign that it, by the way, is an addiction, one, and two, is a dangerous one, because all of the people I know who smoke, they like to have coffee at the same time. So when they wake up, they like a cig and they like their cup of coffee. And that is always the same thing. After lunch, they like their cig and they like their cup of coffee. One, it's a ritual, but more importantly, it's because coffee and the cigarette and tobacco have tied themselves with their dopamine receptors to the point that they cannot really go without it anymore. And any moment in their life where they know that they should be consuming those products, their brain is begging them for it. And so to be able to feel better, they have to give in to the demand. But again, unlike you argue with me that smoking a cigarette every morning you wake up is a good thing, then you have to admit that there is a problem with coffee, because I don't know a single person who tells me, oh, I like to have a smoke before bed and like a piece of pork. No, because the piece of pork is not addictive enough to be able to tie itself with something as addictive as a cigarette. But coffee has that ability, and birds of a feather flock together. Addictions go incredibly well with one another. And anyone who knows addicts will tell you that. For example, people who are addicted to cocaine, usually what triggers the addiction when they're sober is drinking. Because when they drink, they want to sniff and snort cocaine. People who are addicted to heroin as well, alcohol is a trigger. People who smoke, again, if you ask someone when is the time you smoke the most, it's when they're drunk. Because the addictive part of their brain is lit up, and that's when they want to consume that pleasurable product as much as they humanly can. But at no point is it healthy, and the association of vices is the clear sign that there is a problem. So that's for coffee and cigarettes. The other side that this is a clear addiction that needs to be dealt with is the fact that when you quit, you deal with withdrawal. You are tired constantly, you might have mood swings, you might have difficulties to sleep again. All of that is because your body is detoxing itself from all of that caffeine that you consumed. And so that also is a clear sign. By the way, just so that you know, the fact that we're talking about quitting coffee is already an indication that it's not something that's good for you. Because you never hear people say, oh, I need to quit soja. Like, no, because it's not addictive enough to actually be justified in using that type of semantics. And if we go even deeper, look at stimulants. Most people, most young people, call stimulants stims. And every single stimulant, sometimes there are hard drugs like Molly, for example, get a cute nickname as well. This does two things. One, it's what I personally describe as semantical hypocrisy, because it prevents you from having to actually mention the true nature of the thing. You don't really have to face what you're taking. And on top of that, it usually is cute nicknames. Look at Molly, for example. If you tell people, hey, you want to take Molly and go party tonight, they'll say, yeah. If you tell them, hey, you want to take methamphetamine tonight and go party, they'll say no. One is scary, one sounds cute. Stimulants sound scary. Stims sounds cute. And so people say, oh, I take stims. I like stims. But you like them because within your own brain, you have rerouted the very relationship you have with them. And you have made them into something much less threatening, because you understand that their true nature is. And that is the same for every single addiction. Cigs instead of cigarettes. You really need to shorten cigarettes? No, but it is a very palatable way to put into wood an addiction that you know is bad, but that you won't quit because it's very pleasurable. But you're paying that pleasure with the withdrawal syndromes afterwards, which shows to you that all of this was, if anything, a manipulation of sorts. And I'm going to take a very quick break here.
Coffee break!
There's no coffee.
No coffee?
No coffee.
No coffee.
Before I continue with the argumentation and the video about stimulants, I want to make a pit stop right now to recap the points I already presented so that we can move on. So far, I mostly spoke about coffee, okay? And the issue and the problem surrounding this very beverage goes as follows. First off, the very discussion around caffeine and stimulants is not a moral issue, and I want to make that clear. I'm not trying to say that you're inferior to me in any aspect. What I'm saying, however, is that I do believe that what you're doing is detrimental to your health if you have an addiction, which, of course, would first mean that you admit to that addiction. That's a different story, but I want to make sure that I establish that, because I know that a ton of the counter arguments I will get will be based off of that. They will be emotional and they will be ad hominems. And this is just not helping the debate. And it's not helping you in reality because you're trying to deflect. You know, the type of argument that those people use, it's not constructive, all right? Don't try and fire back by saying, oh, well, I do caffeine and you do something else that's also a drug, so it's equal. Even if I did all of the drugs in the wood and I snorted cocaine for breakfast, it still wouldn't make your addiction okay. Whataboutism is not a good way to lead your life because you're going to constantly seek fault in others to justify why you should be able to behave like this. Please protect yourself, protect your health and your true being. Don't be intellectually dishonest. On top of that, you sort of hit a bone with me because I take no drugs. And by no drugs, I mean that I don't consume coffee, I don't drink alcohol, I don't take any sort of hard drugs, I don't smoke, I don't even take medical drugs. I'm opposed to drugs to the point that I don't even take painkillers when I have a headache. So I'm not saying that to tell you that I'm pure. I'm saying that to say that your constant need to point the finger at someone when your addiction is being discussed is a sign that you have a problem. Because if you didn't, you wouldn't be feeling the need to actually act like this. And on top of that, it's very hypocritical because if your response and defense, when someone tells you that your coffee consumption, caffeine consumption is an addiction, is to point the finger at other addictions, then you understand that you have an addiction and that you have a problem. So please be honest, okay? That's all I ask for you. Because this is about your health, it's not about me. This doesn't impact my life. I already don't drink caffeine, as I said. It's more about emotional attachment than chemistry also. I established that with the ritual. I understand that a lot of the addiction comes from the fact that it ties directly to your brain, but it's more than that. If it was just the chemical crutch, it would be much easier to deal with. But coffee is a cultural item nowadays, and it's something that I think I explained fairly well. Most people who drink coffee are addicted, as I established, and they're addicted to the effects, not the taste or the health benefits attached. Okay, you drink coffee because it stimulates you. There is nothing wrong with that per se, but that's the reason. You need to admit that to yourself. The health consequences are hidden for the most part because they don't really reveal themselves, and they are overshadowed by the benefits, which is why I also don't blame you for being addicted. You are always dealing with the positive, which is the fact that you're awake and more aware every day, and you're not really looking at the negatives because they're not as evident. So it's much easier to just push them aside. This is a problem because the issue down the line is that you're missing on sleep, and sleep is essential. I want to insist on that. It's the big reason why caffeine is so bad. It is trading sleep for consumption. And the problem is that it doesn't replace it, but it makes you believe that it does. Sleep is, it's the panacea. Your body is built around sleep. We still have no idea why humans need so much sleep. We don't know. But we know one thing. If you don't sleep, you die. That's all we know. If you don't sleep, you heighten your risk of heart attack, of chronic disease, of cancers. All of which is not a reason for you to stop drinking coffee altogether, but to realize what it does to you, okay? Even if you're the type of person who can still sleep on caffeine, understand that the quality of the sleep and the quality of your condition when you're awake on coffee is not optimal. So it's something to keep in mind because it serves as a crutch to replace sleep. It's not all bad, however, and this is, I think, important to say now, right? I hope that you got that message from me. I'm not saying that it's the devil and you need to stop drinking it. I'm telling you, however, that it's used as a tool. It's used as something that benefits your life. But the day it stops and there are hidden costs that are going to amount to much more than being just awake, this is when you stop. This is when you realize that now you are the one being used as a tool. You're not really in control anymore. And that's, by the way, the definition of an addiction. So that's pretty much that. If you're not addicted, as I said, this video really doesn't concern you. However, it could prevent you from getting addicted. So I want you to stay real because we're going to now move on. I think the chapter on coffee is over because at the end of the day, coffee is the least damaging source of caffeine you can consume for multiple reasons. It might be a bit jarring because I just spent 50 minutes telling you not to drink coffee. But at the end of the day, if you're telling me, man, NH, I love my coffee. I love my stimulant. I do not want to live without it. I would tell you, okay, stick to coffee then. Reduce your dosages, drink as little as you can, but stick to that because there are worst offenders, much worse. And these are pre-workouts. And I'm going to explain to you why they're worse, because at the end of the day, you could tell me, well, caffeine is caffeine. No, it's not even just a question of coffee being more natural per se, although it plays a role. It's that just like with anything in life, coffee in its organical state has drawbacks associated with the consumption of caffeine. And the drawbacks, by the way, are the fact that it's laxative. You enjoy it, but it's in nature, it's supposed to be a drawback because having to take a shit the second you consume something is usually not a good thing. So it's supposed to limit your consumption. Another thing that limits the consumption is the taste. Pure, raw, dark Arabica coffee is really, really bitter. Some people love it. I know people who drink it like this, but a lot of people can't. They have to put stuff in it. And that's also a limiting factor. That way you can't drink too much. And for the most part, I think if the majority of the world stuck to just one cup of dark coffee in the morning, it would be fine. That would be, in my opinion, the threshold of which coffee doesn't have really any negative impacts on your health, as long as you can go a day or two without it, without feeling the drawbacks and the withdrawal syndromes. But the problem is that caffeine has escaped the realm of coffee a long, long time ago, and I think you already know that, because most people don't consume pure coffee. What people consume is anything they can to get the same effect. Anything. And therefore, a lot of the time, they just denature coffee because they're not really after the culinary aspect of it. I know I have people on the channel who love their pure coffee. I'm going to be honest with you. I have also an emotional attachment to coffee, but to the smell. Because to me, nothing smells better in the morning than a cup of coffee. I just don't drink it. But I like having people around me in my life who do, because I love the smell. It brings back good memories. And I know it does for you as well. But for the majority of the world, the way they drink coffee is not like this. They drink coffee mixed with a ton of sugar, creams, or any sort of things that in reality makes them think that they're not drinking coffee, which I think is the best proof that they're not drinking it for the taste. It's for the effect always. And that led to the rise of stuff like Starbucks, where the drinks you get there are an abomination of nature. One, you get shitty coffee for the most part. Two, it's full of sugar. Like those big frappuccino bullshits that people slurp on, there's like 3 or 4 times as much sugar as in a can of Coca-Cola. It is insane. But, and that's the vicious thing about it, if you take just coffee, it's super bitter. If you take just sugar, it's too sugary. But if you put the two together, it's the perfect mix. So now you're going to drink much more coffee and caffeine than you usually do, plus more sugar, because the two sort of counterbalance each other. So things that are not, they're not the devil by themselves, now become it because you consume so much more of it and you don't even feel it. It just goes down your gullet. And that is a problem because guess what I told you earlier? That addictions tend to pair together. People who have an addiction to alcohol, for example, they tend to smoke at the same time because it lights up their brain. Well, what happens when you pair sugar, which is highly addictive, and caffeine? That's the winning combo. Now, every single morning, your brain is going to double crave that dose of caffeine and sugar, and it's going to be even tougher to separate yourself from that. So it's really even worse. That is worse than coffee. Anything you put in your coffee is making it more dangerous towards your health because it's making it more palatable. And that leads also to the topic of energy drinks, which is, if coffee is at 1, and if coffee with sugar and milk is at 3, energy drinks is at 5, in terms of addictive, because they are built to be highly addictive. Look at what they put in your energy drinks. Like, for real, look at it. It's full of edulcorants, colorants, and a ton of chemical stuff. So again, if someone tells me, man, I need my caffeine. Okay, stick to coffee. Do not touch those energy drinks. They are literal poison. And if you want to hear a fun story about them, when I was 13 or 14, I went on a school trip with a good friend of mine in the rest of the classroom. And that friend had an addiction to caffeine. And his poison of choice was Red Bull. By the way, at the time, it was all over the TV. There were Red Bull commercials everywhere, and he sort of fell for it, and he started drinking a ton of it. And what happened to this guy was, keep in mind again, he was 13 in good shape. He had no pre-existing condition. We were on the side of the Vesuve, you know, the big volcano in Napoli. We were climbing up. He was in front of me like 3 or 4 feet. I saw him just faceplant, like straight down, dead. Thankfully, he wasn't dead, but he looked dead. He felt like a plank. And I went to shake him up. He was having a heart attack at 14. You know why? Because he had drank, I think, 4 or 5 Red Bulls in the same day. And for his small body and frame, it was way too much. And the poor guy almost died right there. And you know why he was able to do that? Because Red Bull is very sugary and some people love that. So he just downed them like it was nothing because there was no drawback. If he had had to actually slam 5 mugs of dark coffee, he would have stopped after 1 cup. But the Red Bull was allowing him to get more and more and more in his system. And the caffeine almost killed him because his heart was overstimulated from all of the impulses. And thankfully, he didn't die on that day. And nowadays, his health is perfectly fine. But he quit those drinks. And you really should as well. And if you mix them with alcohol, again, keep in mind what I said about addiction, it's incredibly dangerous. There are countries in this world where mixing energy drinks and alcohol is forbidden for a reason. Their effects together are just as damaging, if not more, than some hard drugs, at least on your system. So really, these avoid like the plague. Please, even if you don't quit stimulants altogether, please quit energy drinks. They're really not good for you. And I don't care how many vitamins they put in there to make you feel better, because I know people like this who say, well, my monster has vitamin D. Cool. What about the rest? It's the same with antioxidants and coffee. It doesn't make up for the deficit. It's still very bad for you, okay? So don't lie to yourself. Plus, look at what they taste like. Some of those drinks, it looks like someone took candy, melted it, and poured it in a can, and you're drinking that. It's terrible for you. So yeah, the palatability of the product makes it more dangerous. And that's something to keep in mind, because if you drink coffee, and you do it because it's fun to feel awake and to feel excited by the caffeine, you are much more likely to fall into the trap of drinking coffee that tastes good on top of that, because you are the type of person, again, that is attracted towards pleasure. And again, it's not a bad thing. I'm not saying you're a bad person, you're human. We love pleasure. Your brain is wired to love pleasure, but it does make you an addict. And the problem with addicts is that they have a tough time facing the reality, because they will always put fun and things that are palatable above the truth and above things that don't really taste the way they want it to taste. And that's just like pre-workouts, by the way. Pre-workouts are the same thing. You will never find a pre-workout that tastes like mud. You know why? Because they want it to taste good so that you keep going back to it. I know it sounds stupid and just evident, but think about the repercussions. Think about what it means. The fact that you keep going back to that same product, that is a marketing dream. And understand also that the fact that it is allowed to sell products laced with caffeine plus sugar should be illegal, because it is a trap. And I know that a lot of people are going to watch this video and maybe discover that they've been entrapped because you just didn't know any better, right? It's if I gave you, like, for example, meth, and I didn't tell you that's meth, you would get addicted 100%. Why? It's designed to addict you. The problem is that meth is still stigmatized to a large extent. Although it's still present in many pills that I'm also against. Even the big pharma pills I am against, because they're just as dangerous. But in this case, they're not prohibited. They're in every supermarket and you see them everywhere, which again should be completely illegal. There should be labels on it saying this product is highly addictive, take at your own risk. But it doesn't happen, does it? Why? Well, because again, in this world, and I perfectly understand why you also don't like this hypocrisy, I don't like it either, there are certain drugs that are bad and some that are good. Well, I say that all drugs are bad, and stimulants and caffeine fall into the same category if taken in excess, if the addiction develops. So that's pre-workouts. You are constantly purchasing a product that within itself contains a molecule that is going to get you to buy more. Like if I told you, for example, hey, I'm going to sell you a toy, and the toy has a chemical property that is going to make you addicted, and every single week you're going to get back to that store and get more of these toys, and on top of that, the toy is going to inject you with a substance that is going to damage your health. You would tell me, man, that's illegal. Well, that's some nightmare bullshit. Well, that's caffeine. That's exactly what you're doing with your coffee. It's the same thing. And again, we could say the same about sugar. The fact that there are products full of sugar that don't disclose it, unless you really look at the label, is also the same mechanism of addiction. Look at white bread. Go to your local supermarket. Look at the white bread. It's full of sugar. Does it need sugar? No. But the person who manufactures the white bread perfectly understands that if he laces the product with sugar, you will come back to buy more because your brain loves sugar. They love it. And therefore, you come back, you buy more. Do you think that these people have your best interest in mind? The answer is no. It's on you to protect yourself. The consumer has to protect himself. So pre-workouts are in the same line as energy drinks. Avoid them. They tie themselves to your dopamine receptors. They are poisonous. And not only do they poison your body, but they have poisoned culture. And that is the point where it personally makes me the most angry. Because if you look at fitness in general and YouTube fitness, caffeine addiction and pre-workout addiction has become the norm. It has been fully normalized. And the problem with that is that I know many people, and I know that many of you on the channel are like this, who discovered fitness along with stimulants. So you never actually lifted without being hyped on stimulants ever in your life. And I personally find it sad, and I'm mad. I'm not mad at you, I'm mad at the people who marketed that bullshit to you because they poisoned your relationship with lifting. You never got to really truly be in a relationship with that product because with that practice because there was always a product in between you and the pure practice and experience of lifting. This is not good. And I know that if you were literally fed that bullshit the second you started lifting, it's maybe too late for you because your addiction is way too massive, but I still want to be that voice that tells you that it was not normal. Your journey and your experience has been damaged by these people, and you have a choice to make. You can end it. I know you can. You have that ability and that willpower, but you have to take that decision. But it's now everywhere. It truly is. Look at Instagram, look at YouTube Fitness. Everyone takes pre-workouts. We make jokes about it, but it's no joke. It is a drug. It truly is. Because to me, there are two ways to categorize the dangerosity of a drug. One, how potent it is per individual, and how widespread. It's the reason why also I won't make a video about heroin, because I know that most of you don't take heroin. But I also know that most of you take caffeine, and that because everyone does, you have started to believe that it's not bad. Because when everyone takes a drug, like alcohol, for example, it becomes normalized and the stigma goes away. But guess what? The stigma might go away, but the health consequences stay. They're still there. Just because no one tells you doesn't mean that they're gone. I will tell you. I don't care if you hate me for it. You need to be reminded of these problems. Because you're most likely part of the ADHD generation. And what I call ADHD generation is the generation that grew up on tablets, on the TV, on the computer, who was most likely fed ADHD medication when you were young because you were a young, energetic, dynamic young male, and this educational system just cannot handle that. They want you to be a zombie glued to your desk, and therefore they fed you drugs to keep you tame. You were poisoned from a very young age, and that's the reason why you have the attention span of a literal legume, and why you most likely have already clicked off of this video, because it was too long and you couldn't focus. But this is also why you love stimulants so much. It's because you lack focus so intensely that the only moment where you can actually be lasered on something is if your brain is stimulated. And considering that you were fed some sort of another of derivative of methamphetamine at some point in your life, it's not surprising. If you were given, what is that thing that they give people to focus? Adderall? Yeah, that's meth. That's like grade A meth. You took that bullshit, and therefore, I am not surprised that you also gravitate towards stimulants. Your brain was wired from a young age. Same for TV. You watch crazy cartoons with like crazy noises and music. Yeah, that killed your brain. You should have been drawing, going out in nature, developing an ability to exist. You never did that. And it's not your fault again. It's your environment. But I know that if you dig deep, you can save yourself from that. It's not a curse. It's not the end for you. But the more stimulants you consume, the longer you stay in that mode, the tougher it is going to be for you to break free from that. And it also explains why you link stimulants to fun. I talked about that before. Some people link alcohol to fun. And this is dangerous because fun is not a drug. Fun is something that everyone can have. People, again, that have never touched any amount of stimulants or drugs can have fun. But the problem is that for you, you are now in an existence where your baseline, the baseline of your ability to feel awake, is much, much lower than what you feel when you're on your stimulants. And even worse than that, most severe than that, your baseline is lower than mine because I never take stimulants. So my baseline is here. And maybe I never go here, but I'm always here. Yours is here with spikes downwards and spikes upwards, which explains also why you cannot fathom the thought of going to the gym or to train without your dear stimulants, is because they have now become the norm within your own brain. And it's also why you think that they're fun, because at the end of the day, they truly are. But they're not fun in absolute terms. They're fun compared to what you feel like without them. And that's the same for every drug, by the way. The drug gives and the drug takes. Every drug makes you come down at some point, because you just can't, you cannot stay high. It's not sustainable. So at some point, you feel that low. But the problem with caffeine is that most likely you never feel it, because the second you start going down, you take it again. You are accumulating a debt. I've already explained that. And the problem here is that, in my opinion, you are confusing two objectives. You're confusing fun with exciting. These are not the same thing. I think that what you want is excitement, because most likely outside of stimulants, your life is fairly boring and what you do on stims is much better. I knew a guy like this who was addicted to meth. And he had so much sex on meth that he could never go back to have sex without the substance ever, because it was just boring to him now. It might be the same for you. It might be that you're going to go back. Maybe you're going to listen to me and go back to the gym without stimulants, and you're going to be bored. You're going to lose performance. It has nothing to do with the stimulants being required. It's just that you've taken them from so long that you have now entered a status and a nature in reality where they are necessary for now. And you're going to have to endure that suck for a long time if you want to get back to where you could be as a normal human, as someone who doesn't need that to exist and to have fun. So I know it's a lot to ask of you, but try to push away the excitement. Try to think long-term and sustainability. If you're young, I might as well piss in a violin, because telling young people to not seek pleasure is a waste of time, but I hope that some of you will listen to my words and my voice here. I understand that pleasure feels good. Yes, I'm human too. I get it. It's a trap. Okay, most of the time, things that feel pleasurable without any effort have hidden costs, and that goes for any single drug. And that is also the problem with addiction. It's impossible to have a constructive discussion with someone who's deeply addicted, because the bottom line of the argument is, drugs are fun, I like fun, I will keep doing them. That's it. There is no real valid argument outside of that for the overconsumption of stimulants, for example. And I think that deep down, you know it. Now, if you decide to tell me, hey, you know what, go fuck yourself, I'm going to take stims for the rest of my life. You do you. It's your life. It's your existence. Doesn't matter to me. But if my words are meaning something to you right now, well, you know what you must do. And for the people, again, who fell into the trap, as I said, I don't blame you. You were the actual victim of insane marketing. Because look at coffee. Let's move away from stimulants to look at coffee for a second. Coffee is not just something that has been ritualized. It's, as I said, part of our culture. In every single country, there is a coffee culture. And most likely, it came from your parents that took it from their grandparents. And we could go back hundreds of years until the date where coffee first arrived in these countries. Now, I want you to think about one thing. Do you think that back then they were educated about caffeine? Do you think that they knew the effects of the molecule on the human body? No, they just thought, if I drink that dark beverage, I'm going to feel more awake and be more productive, so I'm going to drink it. They didn't think twice, but you're not like them. You have access to all of that information that I gave you in this video, so you have no excuse. If you want to do the same thing that they did, you can. There are people who drink coffee the rest of their life and they live a good life, but not if you're addicted. That is the difference. You have the ability to be aware of your addiction, so make good use of that. But at the end of the day, you're the descendant of generations of people who drink coffee, and I'm the same. My parents drink coffee. My grandparents drink coffee. Their great-grandparents drink coffee. So I was in line too, but I was able to sidestep it. And if I wanted to drink it, I think that I could do it in moderation. I also do not believe that just because you touch a drug, you will become massively addicted, but it's a possibility. And so you have to be aware, again, of the product and what it does. And since, addictive substances are everywhere in the product that you buy, in fitness, for example, because, again, the pre-workouts are being marketed just as hard, if not harder than coffee, at least to young people on Instagram and YouTube. Well, it also means that, by default, it's creating an army of defenders, because you're being fed a product that gets you addicted. Not only are you going to buy that product, but you're going to also attack people who point it out as being addicting. And if you don't see that this is exactly what they wanted and that it is the perfect marketing plan, then I don't really have anything to say to you because I cannot help you out of your slump. You are, in a sense, a caffeine zombie. Not only do you overconsume a product that's hurting you, but on top of that, you are aggressive towards people who try to help you, and you are subservient and in adoration towards the people who sell you your drug, just like with, again, any addict. And I hope that by me showing you the strings that tug on you, you are going to be able to recognize them and cut free from them and be finally liberated. Since caffeine addiction is now normalized, I also understand it's the reason why I told you I was expecting resistance. I'm expecting resistance because everyone almost is addicted to caffeine. Some people aren't. Just like some people smoke weed and they're not addicted. Some people take coke, they're not addicted. There is a man on this earth somewhere that takes heroin once a week for like 2 hours and he's fine because he's not addicted. But how rare is that guy? Again, an addictive product is designed to be addictive. If you're not addicted to coffee, you are the outlier. You're not the norm. Most people are. And since you all are addicted, you just turn around and you see other people who drink coffee all the time, and therefore you think that what you do is normal. But it's not. Just because the mainstream does it does not mean that it's a good thing. Look at alcohol again. Look at countries with a big drinking culture. People die from that shit constantly. And yet people still drink it. Why? Well, because everyone is doing it and it's normal. The label of drug has been taken away from alcohol, so people think, well, it's not bad, it's still bad. It's even worse than the hardcore drugs, because you don't know what you're doing, you don't even realize what you're doing. And because of that, you perceive people like me as trying to shame you, or as trying to judge you. I'm not interested in that. I truly am not. I don't need to feel superior to you, in reality. And also, I want you to take something to heart. If you feel that I'm trying to shame you, then at some point or another, you realize that you should feel ashamed. If you're not really versed into philosophy, maybe that sounds foreign, but shame has been pretty much recognized as an internal feeling, meaning that there is not a person on earth that can make you feel shame. You feel shameful, and therefore you project that onto others and you think, what would that person think of me? Or, oh, that person is ashamed of me. But at the end of the day, I cannot inject those feelings in you. I cannot shame you. You cannot shame a person. The person shames themselves, and then they recognize that in others. This is the problem here. Deep down, you know that what you're doing is bad. It's the reason why you feel that shame. So instead of pointing me out as the culprit of that shame, look at the actual culprit. And the culprit is not you. It's the product. I'm not attacking you. I'm attacking the drug. You are not the drug. Your addiction is so bad that you have now identified with your enemy, with your executioner. You think it's you. It's not. I don't think it is. But I think that if you manage to separate yourself from it, at least in terms of identity, it's going to make it much clearer, all right? Because I do not judge you. You judge yourself. So I think I'm going to end that video on that. It was a lengthy video. If you watched it, I appreciate you. Any argument you might have to offer in the comment, let me know. I would love to talk with you. I truly hope that this awakened something in you that you're going to think about your relationship with stimulants. If you need more information in the description again, I put the video about how to get better sleep, how to make your training fun without stimulants, and how to control your adrenaline level to perform in the gym. All things that you have in your power that you do not need to drink coffee or pre-workout or energy drinks to accomplish. Because at the end of the day, I firmly believe that your happiness and your success is not to be found at the bottom of a coffee mug. Thank you for watching. Have a good day.